Hello, film study students, and welcome to your last film lesson. We're also doing the introduction to our sports movie, Raging Bull. Let's get into it. We're going to talk about adaptations. The inspiration from films can come from a variety of places. A big issue, and a lot of people complain about, is when you read a book and then you watch a movie, and the movie never lives up to the book. So films can come from novels, from short stories, from plays, from biographies, from a TV series. Video games, which those don't usually work out. Graphic novels, children's books, magazine articles, and even other films. Let's reboot it, let's make a sequel, and all that good stuff. The problem with adaptations, it's impossible to recreate the experience from the original source, especially if you've read a book. You spend time with a book, you put effort into the book, you have the imagination, you have a picture in your head of what it should look like, and you get to know it. And it takes this long process, and films almost always let you down. They're never as good as the book, with a couple exceptions. Problem one, a change in medium. Films, because of their length, have to leave out parts of the book to save time. Lord of the Rings, that's three long books, and they cut out whole chapters, they cut out whole characters to try to fit it into this as a feature-length film. You have the change in the creative artist. No two creative minds are alike, and sometimes the author and the director, they didn't agree. Sometimes the author's dead and the director does what they want. Like Willy Wonka, Roald Dahl hated that movie. Well, some people say he didn't hate it, but he didn't like the movie version of his book. That's why there's no sequel. That's why they never did the next book in a movie form. There's the cinematic potential of the original work. Some works are just harder to adapt. Some work great. Arguably, the greatest film adaptation of a novel is The Godfather, which is kind of a technicality because Puzo was writing it while they were still filming it. They were still finishing it. Some other adaptations of prose fiction. There's literary versus cinematic points of view. In a book, you get the character's point of view. You get their thoughts, you get their emotions. From a movie point of view, it's where do we want to have the shot? Where's the camera going to be? Do we have a first-person point of view, which is really hard to do in film. You can't truly portray the style without making people motion sick. It has been done in a couple action films, but it just doesn't work. Third-person narrator point of view is good, but then you always have voiceovers, and that doesn't work as well. It's hard to recreate thoughts and emotions and moods. The stream of consciousness and the interior monologue. We have conversations in our head all the time. Hopefully, out there's no replies. But we go through things in our head, and that's hard to recreate in a film. And then the dramatic or the objective point of view. It's not an actual narrator, but the story is being told. That happens as well. There's a problem with the length and the depth. Films are they only use a fraction of what's in the book, unless you're talking about The Hobbit, where they take a smaller book and then they make it into three movies, and it just didn't work. And then summarizing the character's past. How do you get all those details into a film? Unless you have like a really good montage or something. So it's tough to describe the past, and there's other, factors influencing adaptation of fiction. Was the novel popular? Did people like it? For instance, The Da Vinci Code, wildly popular novel. The movie's kind of a dud with Tom Hanks. The books were fun to read because you could try to figure out the puzzle yourself, and in the movie they just did it. It just wasn't as entertaining, didn't grip your imagination. Adapting plays is a little tougher. It's not a little easier, I should say. Excuse me. It's not as different. There's not as many differences compared to book adaptations. I mean, it is. They are acting it out. They are projecting their voices. Plays only though come from one point of view, where you're sitting in the audience. Films can get closer. You don't have to overact. You don't have to project your voice. There are structural divisions. There's a faster pace of film. There's no breaks to change the set. There's no, break in the middle of the play to go get a beverage, to go get a soda. And then there's the sense of space. Plays are set. They're limited. They have a set and you have the stage. Films can go out into the great wide open and you can do wonderful things. There's a difference between film language and stage language. Shakespeare plays as films just don't work as well. I mean, some people love Shakespeare plays and movies, but most people will say it's better to see it in person, to see a live Shakespearean play. And then we have the issue of history. What do you do from based on a true story or based on true events? What does that actually mean? Does that mean it's like going to hold to the letter of history, or do they take a guy and back in the past and let's make it more entertaining? Most mix fiction and fact for entertainment. The movie Braveheart with William Wallace about the Scottish Patriot. entertaining movie, but I mean, you're wearing a kilt, and they didn't have kilts for centuries until after this movie was actually set. It's just they kind of took some liberties there. So, how historically accurate is the film? If you're a historian like me, you go, "That's not true. Actually, that's not true," and then you make everyone around you mad. So, let's talk about sports movies. The American Film Institute, talking about sports movies. They have this cookie cutter kind of format. You have an underdog, or you have a team that underperforms, that nobody believes in, or an athlete that nobody believes in, and they train and they work and they make progress. And usually you have a fun montage with music, and they're working out and they're getting stronger, and maybe they're running through the streets and doing the Rocky thing. And then they overcome adversity. They have this amazing, never would believe it could happen victory. They win the championship, they win the title fight. Hey, and everyone cheers, and you feel good. That's the cookie cutter Disney version of sports movies, and most of them follow into this. So the American Film Institute, their number one film sports movie is Raging Bull, the movie we're gonna watch. Number two, Rocky. So we got back-to-back boxing movies there. Three, Pride of the Yankees, a baseball movie. Four, basketball movie, Hoosiers. Five, another baseball movie, Bull Durham. Six, a pool movie, The Hustler. Seven, the slapstick golf movie Caddyshack. Eight, Breaking Away. I'm not even sure. Nine, National Velvet. Not even sure. That's my bad. As a film teacher, I should probably know those two, but I don't. And then 10, the football movie about the agent, Jerry Maguire. Show me the money. So here's my list. Remember, I'm a basketball guy, but I love baseball too. But number one is Raging Bull. Raging Bull is a phenomenal movie. It is powerful, it is gritty, it will stick with you, and it is hard to watch. I'm not gonna pull any punches here. Boxing pun. It's difficult. It's like going 15 rounds with Jake LaMotta, the main character. You're gonna come out of there emotionally a little bit drained. Number two, Field of Dreams. Love that movie, a little partial to it. Three, Hoosiers, and maybe you're wondering, I'm a basketball coach. But Field of Dreams just kind of hits me in the feels because my son and I went there last or a couple summers ago. We played catch, and the theme of the movie is connecting with your dad, and it just kind of stayed with me. It was kind of cool. Four, Rocky, and I love Rocky. I love Rocky One, Rocky Two, Rocky Three, Rocky Four. After that, just stop. Creed, it's okay. Five, Caddyshack, love it. Six, Remember the Titans, which our school mascot's named after. Go Coleridge Titans, yeah. Seven, Major League, probably the most entertaining baseball movie I've ever seen. I love that movie. It's funny, it's great, it's a good time. Another baseball movie, The Natural. Nine, guilty pleasure of mine, Happy Gilmore. And 10, another guilty pleasure, the basketball movie White Men Can't Jump. So let's get into Raging Bull. Difficult movie. Very powerful though. It is very, very good. Directed by the great Martin Scorsese, who was absolutely addicted to drugs at the time. He was in a downward spiral. His life was going into the gutter. And then his good friend and the star of the film, Robert De Niro, said, "You got to make this movie. You've got to do it. I'm going to act in it." And because of De Niro pushing him, Scorsese claims that he saved his life. He got him to clean up, to get off the drugs, to kick the habit, and to focus on his art. And he made his masterpiece. It stars De Niro, Kathy Moriarty, and Joe Pesci. Who you're gonna love, Joe Pesci's a lot of fun. He's one of the bad guys in Home Alone. Maybe you've seen him on My Cousin Vinny, but he's absolutely filthy and he's pretty funny in this movie. It is based on the memoirs. This is an adaptation of a real memoir of the boxer Jake LaMotta. Jake LaMotta actually served as a producer or a consultant for this film. He was there. The film was shot in two parts. De Niro got in really good shape. He was fit, he was strong, he did all the boxing scenes, and then they took a break for months so De Niro could put on 60 pounds of weight so he could play the older version of LaMotta. While they're making this movie, Jake LaMotta, in a couple scenes, asked some friends, said, "Was I really this bad?" And they said, "Jake, you were worse." He was such a despicable character that they had to like try to make him more likable. They tried. The thing, the title is Jake LaMotta had this inner rage, just urge to fight and just prove how tough he was, and he was so competitive and bullheaded, and that made him a great fighter. But he can never turn it off outside the ring, and so that made him a terrible person at the same time. It's shot in black and white to make it more authentic and also to set it apart from Rocky, which was really popular at the time. Most of the boxing scenes take place in the ring to give the audience the emotion of a real fight. They're usually shot with one camera, often from the The subjective point of view of the boxer. If you feel like you're in the ring, the last fight scene was actually inspired by the shot list and the editing for the shower scene of Psycho. It didn't do well at the box office. It's too gritty. It's rated R. And fans were more into Spielberg and Lucas at that time. It's 1980. This is the year Empire Strikes Back came out. Indiana Jones came out the year before. You have Star Wars. It was just, let's go have fun at the movies. It was nominated for 8 Academy Awards, winning 2 Best Actor, which De Niro absolutely deserved it, and Best Film Editing. Many people think that Scorsese was shorted for Best Director and Best Picture for this film. Scorsese had to wait until the 2000, mid-2000s with The Departed to finally win an Academy Award. There's the real Jake LaMotta. Not only is this the greatest sports movie of all time, this is the fourth greatest food movie of all overall of all the films. It was number 24 in 97. It has made a huge leap. So this is a very good film, even outside of just the category of being sports. 51st most heart-pounding film. Rotten Tomatoes gave it a 97%. They Shoot Pictures, Don't They? Number 23. Scorsese's the 12th greatest director of all time. Entertainment Weekly has it as the 5th greatest movie. Time Magazine, all-time 100 movie. AMC Film Site, 100 greatest film list. De Niro's performance was ranked the 10th greatest performance of all time at Premiere Magazine. Remember that Peter O'Toole and Lawrence of Arabia was the greatest of all time, which we watched. It was voted the 3rd greatest sports movie by ESPN behind Rocky and Bull Durham. On IMDb, the fans gave it a 8.3, making it number 120 of their top 250. So the fans like it as well. The British, not as into it. 53 on their critics list and 12 on the directors. Without further ado, please watch Raging Bull.